So welcome everybody to the today's seminar that will be given by Matthaios Katsanikas. Actually, today we almost not need an introduction, or is an internal speaker's seminar. Matthaios was for years here at the Research Center for Astronomy, at various projects. Anyway, he went to Bristol and came back a few months ago in a researcher C position. Okay, the title of the talk is from a popular subject in our institute about stickiness and work that has been done since many years now about stickiness in 3D Hamiltonian systems, rotating galactic potentials. And he will present us what we know about that until today.
The aim of this talk is the study of the dynamics in the neighborhood of simple and double unstable periodic orbits in a 3D rotating galactic potentials. Here's a phone call this says. We'll study especially the mechanics of stickiness and the importance of this mechanics in this kind of systems. 3D rotating autonomous Hamiltonian systems are of special importance in galactic dynamics. They present in a realistic way rotating galaxies in which the rotation plays a key role in the dynamics on the equatorial plane, but also in the third dimension. In this study, we'll focus to the phase space in the neighborhood of simple and double step periodic orbits of bifurcating families at the region of the vertical resonance 2/1. This resonance is very important because it's due to the role of bifurcating families that we have in this region. And because they contribute in shaping the vertical morphologies of a rotating galactic disk. For example, the peanut-shaped structure that we observe in many rotating galactic disks. And from previous studies, we know the significant role of the chaotic motions in the neighborhood of unstable periodic orbits in this kind of systems. And the aim of this study is to study these chaotic motions in 3D galactic potentials. Until now, the study was restricted only to the equatorial plane of these 3D systems. The system that we use is described by this Hamiltonian. This potential in asymmetric form represents the potentials of the Milky Way. Here we introduce this QA and QB that determine the geometry of the disk. In order to study the phase space,
the spirals are not represented here.
No, it's for a disk. This represents a galactic disk here. For me, the known potential of Miyamoto Nagai, 1975. In asymmetric form, it's for QA and QB equal 1. In order to study the phase space in the neighborhood of a stable periodic orbit, we'll use the method of color rotation. In our system, in 3D autonomous Hamiltonian system, the phase space is six-dimensional. But because the energy, the phase space is embedded, is a five-dimensional, is embedded in this six-dimensional space. And using Poincaré sections, we have a four-dimensional space. For example, here, the Hamiltonian, you can solve and find the value for a y dot. To choose one set of section, for example, y equals 0.
Matho, you have six dimensions, and then you
you have five dimensions because of the energy. Yeah, yeah.
And then by one due to the section.
Exactly. Okay. Exactly. This is that this like six dimensional phase space correspond to this four dimensional space of section. By this way, we define we have a Poincaré map that's a symplectic map, and it's a four dimensional in this case. And for this reason, in order to visualize the phase space, we use the method of color rotation. In this method, we consider three dimensional projections of the space of section. We rotate this feature in order to see this from all sides, and indicate the fourth dimension using color. The smooth color variation corresponds to regular behavior, and the mixing of colors indicate the chaotic behavior in the fourth dimension. Furthermore, this method can detect many using this method, we can obtain a lot of information about the topology in the four-dimensional space. For example, we have if the self-intersections that we have for a structure in the three-dimensional subspace of the space of section is real or not in the four-dimensional. Yes.
Another naive question, one step back. If we have a rotating spiral pattern in the potential, that would not conserve the energy of the
particles, is that correct? No. Except if we have time dependent. If we had a perturbation, we have again autonomous Hamiltonian system.
So if
we have
one pattern speed. Perturbation that goes around, the potential is not.
Yeah, it's autonomous. Dependent. Except if we have two pattern speeds and then we have time dependent. One pattern speed is autonomous.
The energy of the particles will be.
Yeah, exactly. And the role of the perturbation of the spiral for us is the 2i and 2b. Is this exactly the same that if we had the asymmetric potential of Yamato-Nagai plus spiral potential?
So, okay, but here let me add the following. The relation, Marthos said that this represents the potential of the Milky Way. What is the relation of this simple potential with the Milky Way? The only relation is that if you take the axisymmetric part and you draw the rotation curve of that potential as a form similar to the rotation curve of the galaxy, of the Milky Way galaxy. That's all. This is the degree of
similarity.
Exactly.
As Mars said, actually, this is the content of
the potential. It is just the potential with the rotation curve similar to the one of the Milky Way. And you can add a bar, you can add a spiral, you can add a halo, whatever you want. As soon as it is an autonomous system, energy will be consumed.
For us, this perturbation is the change of the geometry of this asymmetric disk.
Energy Jacobi constant, since we have rotating.
Now, for stability of periodic orbits, we use the method of Brooke and Χατζηδημητρίου. As we are doing in the two-dimensional case, we first consider small deviation from its initial conditions, and then integrate the orbit again to the next upward intersection. Now, in this four-dimensional map, we can compute the monodromy matrix. And from the elements of this monodromy matrix, we can compute the eigenvalues and the quantities B1 and B2 that are called as stability indices. These indices are generalization of the non-stability parameter that we know in two-dimensional autonomous Hamiltonian systems. Furthermore, we have another quantity, delta, that is very important in order to distinguish if we have complex stability or not, that we see in the next, as you can see below. Following the notation of Kotopoulos and Magnanat, here I want to underline that we have many kinds of notation. Here in our group, we use this notation, but there is also the notation of Brooke, also other notations, also Stephen Wiggins, also other. Here we use the notation of Kotopoulos and Magnanat, 1985. We have four kinds of periodic orbits. The first kind is the periodic orbits are called as stable. In this case, we have four eigenvalues on the unit circle. Mm-hmm. In the second case, The periodic orbit is called a simpler stable, who have two eigenvalues on the unit circle and two on the real axis. In the third case, the periodic orbit is called a stabler stable, and the four eigenvalues are on the real axis. And finally, we have the case of a complex stability. In this case, the four eigenvalues are complex numbers, but they are off the unit circle. And actually, they form a quadruplet.
What do you mean they are off the unit circle?
Are complex, yeah. But not they don't lie on the unit circle. The collision, the crying most collisions, mm-hmm. happens before the happens on the unit circle, but not at the points one and minus one. This means that we don't have bifurcation of periodic orbits, mm-hmm. but we have a Hopf bifurcation. Mm-hmm. And this, from Kain-Moser theorem, we can have the information if we have if the eigenvalues will leave the unit circle. And this we can see from this delta parameter. If it has negative values, we have complex stability. We have Kain-Moser collision, and the eigenvalues leave the unit circle.
So you have numbers, complex in general, mm-hmm. and then you plot them on the complex plane. Okay? And in the complex plane,
they lie outside the circle.
And furthermore, the stability indices are complex numbers also.
The
betas. The B1 and B2. B1 and B2.
Because this is the definition, as you see.
No.
This is the. If we see in the next slides the stability diagram, mm-hmm. this we have a gap at this time because the P1 P2 are complex numbers. Mm-hmm. Here we have the stability diagram. This diagram gives the evolution of the stability indices versus energy. We depict using red color the stability indices of the central planar family X1. We see at this point that we have a transition for this family from instability to stability. This means that the periodic orbits of this family are initially simpler stable, but at this point become stable. The result is a bifurcation that is initially simpler stable that we call as X1 V2. Actually, this is a subcritical peaceful bifurcation because actually it's not only this family, but introduced in the system this bifurcation two families that are symmetric.
Minus five is not the beginning of. This stability diagram extends to the left as well, right?
Yeah. As Pat said, we must say this because I had to say this in the next slide, but it's better to say it now. On the left side of the figure, we have again the X1 family that initially begins as stable.
Matho, after epsilon equals zero, what is the value of the B1, 2?
Maybe it doesn't exist.
Okay.
No. Here is close to the axis. The B2 index here is close to the B equally minus 2. Okay. And it does not, you cannot see very well because it's close to the axis.
This is not zero.
Yes, not zero. Okay. It's close to the axis, but you cannot see very well because the red is on the black line. On the left side of the figure, also we can see another transition mm-hmm. of the planar family, X1, that there we can see a transition from stability to simply stability. In this case, we have a supercritical principle of bifurcation, mm-hmm. and we have the introduction of two stable families, mm-hmm. The X1, V1, and its symmetric family, that are initially stable. Now we present a representative example if we perturb the initial conditions of a simpler stable periodic orbit of X1 V2 family. And in the first panel, we depict this orbit in the space of section. The three-dimensional projection that we use is x, x dot z, and we color every point of this orbit according the value of z dot, the z dot. Actually, we normalize this fourth dimension, and the zero correspond to minimum value of this orbit, and the of one the corresponds to the maximum value.
Of the z dot?
Yeah, z dot. Okay. Of the fourth dimension.
Yes.
This is the fourth dimension, the z dot. We see also the three two-dimensional projections that correspond to this three-dimensional projection. Here you can see that these branches of this ribbon-like structure that has a morphology of W actually are thin cubes, and they form an angle about 50 degrees. If we see from the top this figure, we see one loop. But if we see this from this projection, we can see these two loops in this three that correspond to these two loops that we see in this 3D projection. Furthermore, we see here the meeting of different colors. This is very important because here we understand that this is not real surface sections in the four-dimensional space. And this is a projection effect. Why we have this projection effect? Because here, actually, we have the conditions of two periodic orbits. Because here we have, because the position of these periodic orbits are identical in this three-dimensional projection. Why? Because we have x1, z2, and symmetric family. In this case, they have the same x, x dot, and z, but they have different z dot. This means that in three-dimensional projection, we'll have identical position, but the colors that indicate the fourth dimension will be different. This is the reason that we see the meeting of different colors also at the extreme values of this color palette. And the points drift away from the central area following different color variation from these two different initial conditions. We can see better this if we go to the other three-dimensional projection. Here we have the three-dimensional projection x dot. X dot, z, and z dot. And the fourth dimension is x, value x. Here we see that we have different z dot values. This is the reason that the one position is here, is at the top, and the other is at the lower part of this single loop structure. And here we can understand here better why we have a one loop, actually, in the fourth dimension. Because here we have a single loop structure and smooth color variation. As we can see, all these structures confined in the four-dimensional space, and we have a well-defined structure. This indicates maybe the phenomenon of stickiness that we'll see and we'll analyze in the next slide.
In the first case, the color enables you to discriminate a phenomenally common point.
Yeah, exactly. That we see this projection effect better in the other projection, but we have different position here for this initial conditions. This is one of the advantages of a method of color rotation that can detect this real or not real surface sections in the four dimensional space. Mm-hmm. Something that we cannot see, for example, in other methods. For example, use method of 3D slices. For more intersections, the points leave this initial structure and form this theta structure. Here we see a structure that resembles this theta structure, but also we will see a mixing of colors. This indicates a chaotic behavior in the fourth dimension. The projection that we use is x dot, z, and z dot, and we color according the value of x in the x direction.
This is the same orbit, right?
Yeah, yeah, the same orbit, but for more intersections. They have left the initial structure and they form another structure.
The choice of the coordinates of the section is based on
based in order to see to obtain the most valuable information about the structures if they are confined in the same neighborhood or to understand the topology of the structures.
You have to rotate the
yeah, yeah, exactly. We rotate also the feature in order to see all the properties of this surface. Here we can say that initially we have more green colors for the points for the first 500 intersections after this after the time that the points leave the left the initial structure. But as we increase the intersections, we see more points with blue and red color, and we start to have mixing of colors. This happens because we have an expansion of the range in the x dot projection. And the method of color rotation detects this expansion as we evolve the orbit in the space of section. In order to see better this the previous structures, we take these two-dimensional projections. I can see all the structures that we have in the neighborhood of this simple unstable periodic orbits. Here we choose the projection set Z dot. This red ellipse with corners is correspond to the initial structures that we saw, the ribbon-like structure. These corners, we see the two points, the two locations of the periodic orbits of X1, V2 family and its symmetric family. For more intersections, the points left the structure and and they form this theta structure. This structure is indicated from this black white arrows. We see that we went around these curves that they are surround these black points. These black points indicate the position of the stable periodic orbits of X1, V1, that are the families of the previous peaceful bifurcation from the X1, V2, of the supercritical peaceful bifurcation of X1. And here, these lines here, the curves, are the projections, two-dimensional projections, of the invariant tori around this stable periodic orbits. We see that this theta structure went around this invariant, this of these projections of the invariant tori. Then the points form a ring that is close to the neighborhood of these eight black lines. These black lines are projection of very small tori around a stable periodic orbits with period eight. And stuck for a long time here until they start to diffuse in the phase space. In order to understand better the previous structure, we compute the asymptotic curves of stable in the stable manifolds. This we can do it taking initial conditions close to the periodic orbit. For example, here, the periodic orbit is x0, x.0, z0, and z.0. And we take many initial conditions on the in the direction of the unstable or stable eigenvector. And we integrate forward and backward respectively. In this case, we found two parts of for the unstable manifold. The same structure we have also for the stable manifold, the same topological structure. In the first case, for positive for negative values of Z, the unstable manifold has the same structure as the ribbon-like structure that we saw in the first slide. But for positive values of Z, for Z, we have a different behavior. Initially, for 16 initial conditions in the direction of this of the unstable Antian vector. We see that the asymptotic curves went around the position of the periodic orbit in this three-dimensional projection with smooth color variation. This means that this occurs in the four-dimensional space. But for more intersections, we see more oscillations in the Z direction. And for more initial conditions in the initial segment, we have a large range of these oscillations in the Z direction. But also, we can see the ring-like structures that we have at the center. That correspond to the initial intersections that we saw in the previous slide. Now, for the other projection, if we use x dot, z, and z dot, we have here the position of periodic orbit. And we have asymptotic curves. And we have one oscillation on the one side. And we observe smooth color variation. As we add more intersections and more initial conditions on the initial segment that we use in order to compute the unstable invariant manifold, we have more oscillations on the other side of the periodic orbit. And finally, we have many asymptotic curves that start to fill a structure that resembles this theta structure that we saw before. As we can see, this has a filamentary structure. And this is because the parallel oscillations that we have for these asymptotic curves close this close the periodic orbit. Now, what happens with the previous structures and what relations they have with the invariant manifolds and the stickiness? As we know from the two-dimensional case, we have many times that orbits stuck in specific chaotic regions far away from the presence of tori. This happens because many orbits follow stuck on the unstable manifold for a long time before they diffuse in the phase space. Here we compute. Here we present using red color the unstable invariant manifold of the periodic orbit of X1, V2, the path A, as we saw before. And using blue color, we depict the ribbon-like structure that we saw in the first slide. Here we see that this stuck for a long time on this structure in all projections, X, for example, X, X dot Z, and X dot Z and Z dot. We remind also that we have found for these structures that they have also smooth color variation. This means that this occurs also in the four-dimensional space. This means that we have the first case of stickiness for this structure. Now, when the intersections leave the initial structures of the ribbon-like structures and they form this theta structure, go and far away and stuck almost on these asymptotic curves of the theta structures of part B of the unstable of the unstable manifold of the periodic orbit of X1, V2. And here stay for a long time until the points start to diffuse in the phase space. Here's another case of stickiness. And this is the second structure that corresponds to stickiness in the neighborhood of simple state periodic orbits. Now, we've got the case of doubly stability. For a value of energy, the X1, V2 becomes doubly unstable. And in this case, we have four eigenvalues on the real axis. Two correspond to the stable manifolds, and the other two correspond to the stable manifold. What this means that now we have a two-dimensional eigensurface for the double state periodic orbits. If we perturb the double state periodic orbits of the families X1, V2, we have clouds of points and stop chaotic behavior. This happens because in this case, the eigenvalues or the two eigenvalues have a big difference. And this means that the points go faster in one direction than the other direction. Now, here we compute the asymptotic curves that correspond to the one eigenvector, not the eigensurface, but the one eigenvector, because this eigensurface is composed from the asymptotic curves that correspond to the two, to both of the eigenvectors. Here we have the periodic orbit. Here we present, we have a smooth covariation, and we show a loop below this periodic orbit. The color follows this smooth covariation, and then we have an oscillation actually between the red and green, green and the yellow. And this also, we can understand an oscillation of the color, the fourth dimension. And after this loop, big loop, the asymptotic curve goes outside from the box, far away. The same happens for the asymptotic curves that correspond to the other.
This one is the faster one, or the slower?
This is the faster. Yeah. And this tells you that it's very difficult to visualize the eigensurface because we have this difference. And here, only that you can visualize is the asymptotic curves that correspond to every of that correspond to every of these eigenvectors. Now, this is the reason also that we have this Tom Haughty behavior, that we don't have stickiness in the previous case. Now there are cases that we have double stability, but the eigenvalues are very close. In this this case, we can counter this case for other family, z-axis family. This family lies entirely on the z-axis. That's the rotation axis of the system. If we perturb the initial condition of this periodic orbit, that is at the center, in these two-dimensional projections, we see this eight-shaped structure. If we apply the method of color rotation, we have mixing of colors. This means that we have a chaotic behavior, but it's confined in a specific region of the phase space. And these two black points represent the points of periodic orbits that we say as stable anomalous orbits. That is a bifurcation of the z-axis family. Is again, it's a supercritical piece of bifurcation of the z-axis family. And this green and magenta circle is the project are the projections of our invariant tori around this periodic orbit. For longer time of integration, the points start to diffuse in the phase space. What happens here? If we compute the Lyapunov characteristic number, we can see that we have we can see the strong chaotic behavior, the initial chaotic behavior of this eight-shaped structure. And here it starts to levels off in to a positive number. We have a small decrease here, but here at this point, it starts, the points leave the structure. And eventually, the Lyapunov characteristic number starts to increase, something that we saw also using the method of color rotation, because they leave the structure, and we have the increase of this of the Lyapunov characteristic number.
The bottom figure is the continuation.
Yes, the continuation of this
of the upper figure.
Yeah. Now we computed the invariant manifolds for the case that we analyzed before. We see this eight-shaped structure in three-dimensional projections of the face of the space of section. And a smooth color variation on this surface with a complicated pattern. For example, here we have an intersection of external and internal surface of this eight structure. And here we see the projection, the two-dimensional projection of this eigen surface. And we can see better the central oscillations close to the periodic orbit. This is exactly the surface that we saw before for the points, because the points stuck on this surface. for a long time before they diffuse in the phase space. Furthermore, we see here that this structure does not wind around the projection of invariant ori. This happens because the topological dimension of the unstable manifold is the same with the topological dimension of the invariant ori in this case, because here we have a two-dimensional invariant manifold and two-dimensional invariant ori. In the previous case that we have the asymptotic depths to wind around the tori of x1, v1, we have the case that we have a lower topological dimension objects, for example, and specifically it was one, to follow topological objects that had the topological dimension equal to. The conclusion is that we found dab loops and theta structures in the neighborhood of simpler state periodic orbits. In this case, the asymptotic depths are one dimensional in the space of section and wind around following topological objects with higher topological dimension. We have eight shaped structures in the neighborhood of double state periodic orbits. And also we have cloud of points that we have strong chaotic behavior and direct transitions to chaos. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Marcos. So let me add some comments. The new thing in all what Marcos presented is the third dimension. Actually, one could understand it easier if there was an example in two dimensions, then we could see also what happens in the third dimension, right, at the third dimension, because there is a correspondence. And one of the new things is one can appreciate only if I understand the technical difficulties. These manifolds in the third dimension are not easily calculated. But now you can see, and then you, on the slides, one could see what is the corresponding situation when we have this stickiness in care. That means that the intersections of the orbit with the surface of section, the space of section, remains for a long time close to these manifolds. And then this has also implications for the supporting maybe of a structure. I'm kind of close to the microphone.
Too close.
No, it's okay. It's okay. We have some instabilities in the network, but it's okay. Fine. So, if the audience, Yannis, want to ask something.
Again, naive questions. Can anyone repeat, do the whole calculation and compare what Pano says with the two dimensional problem, exactly the same problem, and show exactly the surface of sections and the plots of two dimensions? Would they be different or ignoring completely the z direction? Just plot x and y dot, just the two dimensions.
Yeah, we see different tests because here we have also different kinds of periodic orbits. In in two dimensional case, the surface of section, we have only one dimensional asymptotic case. Here we have K four dimensional space of section. And also we have two dimensional invariant manifolds in the four dimensional space of section. We have different topology, different dynamics.
The direct comparison can be done between the simple unstable, what was called simple unstable, and the 2D case, right? Then you can see this 2D case on the equatorial plane, let's say of the galaxies, a long known situation. In the 80s and the 90s, there were a lot of work done on this. Now, of course, it is added the third dimension. There is also some difference even in the simple unstable case, because you can have perturbations on the equatorial plane, then compared with the two-dimensional case, but also away from the equatorial plane, then you don't have it.
Yeah, yeah.
And of course, you forget about double instability, which is a phenomenon that appears in three dimensions.
And also, we have the case that we around higher topological objects in the three-dimensional case for simple stability.
These were all plots from old works. But now we technically understand some tools better. For instance, despite that we are in the four-dimensional space of section, there are some projections that, especially for the dynamics in regions of the vertical of 2-to-1 resonance, vertical inner Lindblad resonance, as we say, have been proven that can provide a lot of information. Matthaios has shown the Z dot projection. This gives a lot of information that is not presented analytically here, but we have developed also the tools about that. Okay, so let me check if there is someone else in from the.
I don't see something.
Someone else who wants to see anyone who wants. Then let's thank Matthaios again.